go over something, a topic that is very dear to me, because when God actually revealed His Word to me on what we're going to talk about, it changed everything about how I read the Bible and my understanding of just what Jesus Christ did on the cross, how He lived His life and how He died and the reasons why He suffered and died. And it's one of the things that we don't really think about. We've heard many things about the life of Christ and the death of Christ, but there's a few phrases, a few words that came to mind when I was studying this years ago, and it made a huge impact on the way I acknowledge His life and death. One of the things that, what's the first thing on your paper there, what's the first thing that pops into your mind when you define the life of Jesus Christ? Not the death of Jesus Christ, the life of Jesus Christ. Am I on? Bink? Is it on? Maybe the battery. It's going. Huh?
It's not going to work until we do this. Okay, hold on.
Gotta wait for the technician. You got it? Okay. So here's some words, right? We have sinless, perfect, God in flesh, holy, Savior, Redeemer, all these names, okay? But there's one word that I didn't hear that came to mind. What's that?
God.
Okay, not that.
Obedient.
What?
Obedient.
Thank you. Obedient. The one word that came to mind going through this was obedient. Because when we look at these words up here, when the sin of man is placed upon Christ, these characteristics are no longer on Him. He is condemned. He has sin. He is just like every human being that's ever lived is a sinner. Condemned to hell, unrighteous, enemy of God. He becomes that at that moment when the sins of man is placed upon Him. So we want to look at first in this obedience that he's going to display. It happens in first in Luke 2, 41 and 52. So if you want to turn to Luke 2, 41 to 52. It says, "Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up according to the custom. And when the feast was ended, returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it. But supposing him to be in the group, they went a day's journey. But then they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, 'Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress.' And he said to them, 'Why are you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?' And they did not understand the saying as he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart." So what happened in this? This was a tradition that all Jews would go to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. It was a celebration. Okay, but Jesus at the age of 12, he is now considered son of the law. Okay, and because when he's labeled the son of the law, that means that he understands everything that has been taught to him by his parents that God has ordained for him to know about Passover, about sacrifice, everything that he has to know. He's learning this at the age of 12. The Passover feast, people would travel by caravan. In other words, a whole group of people would be traveling to Jerusalem for this. And when they traveled, men would travel with men and women would travel with women, whether it be front and back or side to side. Don't really, it doesn't matter. It's the fact that they traveled in groups of women with women and men with men. And most of the time, the young kids would travel with the women. So when they, after the Passover feast was over and they're traveling back, what's going on here? They assume that Jesus is with the family. So Joseph could be thinking that Jesus, being 12 years old, still not quite a man yet, is still traveling with the women. Where Mary, on the other hand, she might be thinking, because he's the son of the law, he's now adequately equipped to walk in the group of men. But he's needing neither of them. He's in Jerusalem still. So now they go searching for him for 3 days. They come back and they realize that here he's in the temple talking to the schooled teachers and the scholars of God's word. And so what's happening here? What do we see in verse 46? What does it say? They find him doing what? Sitting in the temple among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. 12-year-old boy asking questions? How can this be? How can this young boy be asking us these hard questions? And there, what does it say in 47? They were amazed on his answers. And Jesus at this point in time is fully aware now of what he is doing. His identity with God, the Father. He is aware of it. He's no longer... He was taught to be obedient to his mother and father, because that was a command, and he was fulfilling that. But now he is identifying himself with the Father in heaven. And how do we know that? Because it says in verse 49, "Why are you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" Or there's another translation that says, "Did you not know that I am about my Father's business?" What is his Father's business? His Father's business is to be telling, he's telling truth about his Father, telling people about sin, redemption, holiness, grace, mercy, judgment, eternal life, his own life and his own death. And he's, and in verse, in 1 John 3:8, right here, what does it say? It says, "Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, and the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil." And what is the works of the devil? Sin. Death. Anything that is contradictory to God's word and contradictory to God is of the devil. And here he is, and on your page, in your first... you got a little fill in the blank on your first page there. He came to destroy the works of the devil. There's never been a more important relationship between two persons other than the Father and the Son together. God sent his only begotten Son to his own creation that has now been corrupted by sin, in order to save those who believe on what he is going to do and what he did on the cross, to save them from his own impending wrath that is coming to them. The relationship also has to be, is that the Son has a perfect obedience. He became flesh, as Kirk was talking about last week. He became 100% man, 100% God. The only difference is that the creation that he is involved with is all about sin, where he was had no sin and never could sin. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. 100% sinless. Jesus Christ had to be 100% sinless in order for us to be able to be saved. If he wasn't sinless, then we'd all be in trouble. And while he was here on earth, he was also tempted. In the Gospels, he was tempted by Satan. He was led out to the desert, the wilderness, to be tempted. And he never came to sin. He never fell to temptation. Hebrews 4:14-15 says, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." So if we think that our lives are so terrible, and we can't go through weaknesses of time of troubles, and we just think that nobody can understand what we're going through, it says that he can sympathize because he knows our weaknesses. He was tempted just as we are. So he knows, and he totally understands everything that we go through. So that gives us more of a reliance upon him and looking to him in places where we might suffer, we might have anguish, we might have some troubles in our life. We can go to him because he does know. We're not alone in this. He's there for us. He can sympathize with us. And everything Jesus did was in perfect obedience from he was 12 years old on to the cross. He was to glorify God in all things. That's what he came to do. So the relationship between the Father and Son is on your next page, on the back of your handout, the first page. And there's quite a few verses that demonstrate how he was obedient to the Father's will, and also the relationship between him and the Father were perfect. Matthew 3:17, the expressing of his pleasure on his Son. God is expressing his pleasure upon his Son. You can look at these verses. I'll just tell you what, kind of give you a highlight on each one. Matthew 26:39, Jesus obedient to take the cup as the Father wills. Not his own will, but as the Father wills. In Matthew 26:42, Jesus again prays for the Father's will to be done. In Matthew 17:5, Mark 9:7, and Luke 9:35, is at the Mount of Transfiguration. The Father tells Peter to listen to his Son. In Luke 3:21-22, highlight 22, Jesus' obedience is baptism, and the Father is pleased with him. He not only is pleased with him, he says to my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased. In John 5:19, 24, and 26, Jesus does what the Father does. He said, whatever the Father does, whatever the Father says, that's what he does. John 5:30, Jesus again seeks the Father's will. John 5:36-37, the Father bears witness about the Son. In John 6:27, God's own character, his own seal is upon his Son. And it's a, the distinctive mark of pure holiness is upon his son. John 6, 37 through 40, Jesus came down from heaven to do the will of the Father. John 11, 41 and 42, so when he's praying to raise Lazarus, and he says, it's Jesus gives thanks to the Father for hearing his prayers. In John 17, 1, Jesus asks the Father to glorify the Son so the Son can glorify the Father. John 17, 5, Jesus asked to be glorified as he and the Father were before the world existed. He's always been glorified. He was glorified before the world, before the foundations of the world, with the Father in heaven. We got a couple more. John 8, 54, it is the Father who glorifies the Son. John 13, 31 and 32, God glorifies himself in the Son, and God glorifies him in himself. You want me to repeat that one again?
Yes.
Okay. God glorifies himself in the Son, and God glorifies him in himself. And the last one, John 14, 13, God is glorified in the Son. Now these books that are up here on the board, they are the most important description of Jesus' obedience to the Father's will. Back. Okay. They depict that Jesus is praying for the, he's in the garden, and he is praying that the cup may pass, but it's not his will, it's the Father's will, and the Father's will be done. I know that to think about going through this on the cross, the possibility and the implications are not so much that it's the sins that are going to be overwhelming to him. It's not the death that is going to be overwhelming to him, but the separation between him and the Father is something that he has never experienced before. And what he is going to experience through the separation is causing him great agony, distress, and so much so, there's a description here that we're going to cover that maybe medical people, Nancy maybe, and whoever else is in medical here would know there is a possibility that you can sweat blood because of the what your body is going through, the distress. It can actually produce blood coming from your pores. So at this time, Jesus is experiencing the overwhelming sorrow of Matthew 26:38, where he says, "My soul is very sorrowful." And this Greek word is lepeo, And this word is distressed. The word sorrowful is distressed in the Greek. Even to death, remain here and watch over me. He's praying. He's telling his disciples, stay here and pray and watch over me because I am in great distress. Now he's feeling the weight. He's feeling the intensity already as to what's going to be happening to him on the cross. Not only on the cross, but it's the separation that he's going to be facing. We got Luke. Okay. And in Luke, it's describes here in 22:42, it says, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from before me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, which this word agonia is a violent struggle within. His violent struggle within himself, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. So we can see that he knows what's going to happen. This life that he has been living with perfect harmony, perfect obedience to the Father, he's not questioning, saying, I don't want to do this. He's saying, if it can be done another way, but it's your will, not my will be done. It's always going back to the Father's will, not his own will. And he's seeing that this perfect relationship that he has with the Father is now, he's going to be separated. And it's killing him. It's driving him into agonies, big time troubles within. Now, the life that he's living and the life that is going to expire and what he's doing on the cross, there's something going on in today's world that I have a really, really hard time with because I hear even Christian people saying the same thing. And there's this thing called all lives matter, black lives matter, okay? True, okay? Pastor Bobby hit on it about a couple weeks ago, that our lives mattered when Jesus died. So when we think about, we go back to Genesis, and God sees that everybody that he has created is evil, is consistently doing evil, except for one person and his family. He destroys the earth by water, by flood. Now, let's go through the Old Testament a little bit and say, what if years later, we still find that God is displeased with his people and says, you know what, I'm done. I'm going to start over again. I'm going to wipe everybody out. I'm going to keep the line going to my son, but I'm going to wipe everybody out. And he does. Whose lives matter then? The ones that were righteous in his sight. So we keep going. Keep going up to the prophets, minor prophets. A lot of evil going on. Why didn't God could have said, no, I'm stopping it again. I'm going to start all over again. Wiping out all the people except for the ones he sees that are righteous in his sight. What lives matter then? Only the ones that he sees are righteous, that are obedient to him. So then we come up to today. It is so bad that Kirk said last week, it's Sodom. We're living in Sodom and Gomorrah. Why doesn't God stop right now and say, I've had enough of this. We're starting all over again. Whose life really mattered? Well, we're finding out that it was Christ's life that mattered. It wasn't ours. We would be insignificant if Christ never came. Our lives would have no bearing on anything if the life of Christ was never here. So it's not all lives matter. It's not black lives matter. It's Christ's life that matters, not ours. But when he died on the cross and he saved us, then our lives mattered because he took our place and he saved us. He saw us as forgivable. and savable. So it's the life of Christ that matters, not our own. In Philippians 2:5-8, says, "Have this in mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped." That's anthropomorphic, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Okay. Well, it's hard to grasp this, that here, you know, God in flesh, that's one of those terms that it's hard to understand that he is inequality. He didn't see that we could even understand this. But emptied himself, or humbled himself, by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So again, all the words that we say up there are true. The ones that this displayed earlier, they're all true about him. But if he wasn't obedient, then they'd be false. So Jesus' death, we're going to be touching on this here in just a second. Something happens when Jesus is on the cross. And he cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? This is the final climactic part of his life, where all the sins of everybody, past and present, was placed on him. He is now crying out, why have you abandoned me? Why have you left me here to suffer alone? Why have you turned your back on me? Well, the reason why is because God cannot look at sin. Our sin placed on the Son, God now turns his back on his own Son. And when I got saved, and I was going through some Greek studies, this word forsaken was the one that absolutely crushed everything that I ever thought I knew about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It was the most crushing thing to me, because it was my sin that severed this relationship between God and the Son. This perfect holy relationship from the very beginning of time, before time, is now severed. God can't look at him anymore at this moment, because of the filthiness of myself is placed on him who is perfect. And God turns his back on him to suffer alone. He abandons his own Son for the guilt of our sins. And Hebrews 2:10 says, "But we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone." So here he is, he has to taste death. He has to go through it. So we wouldn't have to face this second death. I was talking to a kid. I do a Bible study with one of my players over at Golden West. And we were talking about this. And I said, "Do you understand that the person that's a non-believer has one birth and two deaths? And the saved has two births and one death?" And he kind of like, "No, I don't understand that." I said, "Well, we're talking about spiritual death and human death. We're talking about human birth and spiritual birth." In other words, when the person who, we all have a earthly birth, human birth, everybody has it. We're all gonna face death at some time in our life. But the person who has a earthly birth, human birth, when he is redeemed, he is saved by Christ, he has a spiritual birth. There's our second birth. And because of that spiritual birth, we will only face death one time, and that's that human death here on earth. but we will have life afterwards. Said, well, the second one is the person who's not saved is going to face, he's going to have a human birth, he's going to face a human death, and then if he's not right with God, he's also going to face a spiritual death, which is life, eternal punishment. That's what he's saying, is that he tasted death for us, and that death is the death that he is punished for us. So in this, he's on the cross, and he's recognizing the oncoming spiritual death that he is going to face because of our sins that are placed upon him. The separation of God is he takes our substitutionary. He is our substitute. And that one of the things I said to the kid the other day was that it's like a substitute teacher. You have a teacher that you've seen all this time, and all of a sudden they're not there. Why? Because somebody's taking their place that day. They're filling in for that person. Well, that's what Christ did. Christ, we're supposed to be on that cross. Because we're not good enough to do so, we had to have something, not something. The Old Testament, something had to die. In the New Testament, someone had to die. And that someone had to be perfect, holy, and righteous. And that was Christ. He took our place so we wouldn't have to face this spiritual death that we should take. He took it for us. And that's that substitutionary act on the cross. He becomes condemned for us. Because God in his holiness can never accept sin into his presence, he had to put his own son on that cross to do the things that he would do of a person who would reject him. He treated his son as a person who rejected him. Turned his face away from his righteousness, and his righteousness, he became unrighteous on our behalf. So this word that we find, these three words, it is finished. It's on your papers there. When I was talking to Kirk about this on Friday, I started thinking about this, and I've heard people say this before, that when you hear these words, it is finished, some people might say that it was the ending of his suffering. Okay? Or the ending of his incarnation here on earth. Like his time on earth is over with. Hey, it's finished. It's all done. Now I can go with the Father. And I also heard that he was fully aware of the prophecies of the Old Testament, and that he was going to fulfill those prophecies all the way to his death. Okay? But when he said it is finished, it's a legal term, and Kirk would know this, he's an accountant, that it is a payment completely paid off, full. Am I on that one? Oh, no. Here we go. And the Greek word is teleo. Means the full payment of a price or the discharge of a debt by a complete payment. When he said it is finished, he has now fulfilled the requirements that God has placed upon him to save the people from their sin, those who he is going to save. It was his blood was the debt. The debt had to be paid. Blood had to be shed. Throughout the Old Testament, we read that blood was always the sacrifice. The blood was always sprinkled on the temple, all around the temple, everything that had to do with the temple, the blood was spread, sprinkled all over the place. So blood had to be shed. And when a person would go through this ceremony, he would place his hands upon the animal, and he would confess the sins into the animal. Now, the animal has no idea what's going on, okay? But it was the fact that it was the transfer from guilt and sin is placed on the animal, and now that animal had to be slaughtered. Blood had to be spilled. And in doing so, God saw that as a partial atonement. It wasn't a full atonement, it was partial. So what happens when this goes on with Christ on the cross and he cries this out? The transfer of account is taking place. This is called imputed righteousness. Has anybody ever heard this term or not heard this term? Okay. This is a term that it's one of these things that it's hard to grasp onto, but by faith we can look at it and just be so thankful that God did this. It is a transfer of accounts, a transaction, in other words. That God placed our account. We have Jesus' account and man's account. Our account, we're sinful, unrighteous, enemy of God, and the list goes on. These are just three that you can say these are for sures. But the list goes on. Jesus' account, sinless, righteous, Son of God, holy, perfect. List goes, I mean, he's got more lists than we have. So these are our counts right here. When Jesus cries this out, it is finished. The transfer has occurred. Our account, man's account, we become, in God's eyes, sinless, righteous, Son of God. Jesus takes our account. He becomes sin who knew no sin. He becomes unrighteous because of our sinfulness. And now he becomes an enemy of God that we were once. Remember, this is only for 3 days. It's not for very long. But for this moment, God turns his back, and now you see why God turns his back on his own son. But now God, because of this transfer of accounts, now God looks at us and says, you have my son's righteousness upon you. You are my son. You have my son's righteousness. You have my son's characteristics about you now. So you are a son of God now. So man's spirit, man's sins, spiritual death, separation from God, he took upon himself. And that's one of the questions I always ask myself is, why would you do that for me? And it's an ongoing question. Not that I'm concerned about it. It's the fact that he did it and I don't deserve it. And there's an old gospel song that is probably one of my favorite songs called, I can't remember it now. Who Am I? The song is called Who Am I? And the song talks, it's about, who am I that you would die for? That you would say, not my will, but your will be done. And it's the same question. Who am I that you would do that for? And it's an ongoing thing. It's a very humbling notion to think that the creator of the universe saw fit to take somebody like me and say, okay, I loved you so much that I want to die for you. I want to take myself and put it, my son on the cross, myself, God in flesh, on the cross for you. I don't understand why, but I will take it. I will take it and I will live it out because I am so grateful and thankful that that's what occurred. And Pastor Jerry Ragg in Florida, he was talking about this same thing. And he said, thank God that he sent Jesus to pay that price. He says, I am so thankful that God sent Jesus to pay that price for me. Now, because of this, now we are in right standing with God. That's called justification. We've been justified. We're in right standing this way here with God. But now what do? We have to go this way and tell people about God and His goodness and what He has done for us. It's right standing with God here, but now it's going out and talking to people about who God is and just what He has done. In Romans 3, 21 through 26, go ahead and turn to Romans 3. There's too much to put up on the board, so I didn't put it up there. 21 through 26. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Does that mean we fall once? No, we always fall short. Every time we sin, we have fallen short. But thanks to God, He puts us back in right standing when we confess our sins to Him. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in His divine forbearance He had passed over former sins. It was to show His righteousness at the present time so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. He becomes the justifier because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Jesus justifies us. He puts us in right standing. And then right after that, in verse 27, says, then what comes of our boasting? It was all the work that He did on the cross. All of the suffering, all of the separation, all of everything that He went through was for us. And to think that people one day are going to die and they're going to be separated. To think that if it was that bad for Christ and He was going through this turmoil, this struggle from within, sweating blood droplets out of his own skin, that struggle enough right there, it's a perfect description to show this is not what we want to go through. We should want people in our own families to know that this is something you don't want to go through. If Christ is struggling with it, knowing that the separation between Him and the Father is going to be that bad, that's a great illustration for us to know that we should be feeling the same way about our own loved ones, about people that we work with, that we should be struggling within to know that, hey, these people are going to be separated. So God cannot look at His Son because He is drenched in our sin. He can now look at us as His own children, fully justified, fully righteous in His sight, but only through the blood of Christ. The death of Jesus Christ is remarkable. It's a remarkable event, and it is all about how God orchestrated it, how God worked it all out. There's no script that could ever match what Christ and what God did. That relationship between God and the Father, or Jesus and the Father, it permeates today. Because when He died, He was buried. He rose again. And where is he sitting right now? Right hand of the Father. So that relationship is back on. And it is much better, much stronger than it was when he was down here. Because the sin corrupted him. Now he's perfect and holy and sitting at the right hand of the Father today again. But he's not only there, he's here too. And he's watching over us. He's guiding, he's directing us. The Holy Spirit is active in our lives, in our being. So what when Jesus died, we have power over what? Sin and death. We don't have to face this upcoming death with wrath behind it. We're not going to face that. We also have the power through the Holy Spirit to say, look at something that's sinful and go, no, I'm not doing that. We are no longer what they call, what I call the natural man's instincts. The natural man's instincts show up every once in a while. But we now, God has changed us. 1 Corinthians 5:17, we are a new creation. We don't have to, and we don't desire to do things on our own. It's the will of the Father. Just like Jesus is giving us the example of perfect obedience, we want, our desire should be to be obedient the same way. And also our desire should be to do the Father's will. What is the Father's will? To go out and preach his word, talk to people about who he is, and live a life that is serving and pleasing to him. So we are not enslaved to sin. It does not have any a dominion over us, and neither does death. Oh, I went too far. Okay. Romans 6, 9, 11, and 14. I don't think that's up there, but I'm going to read it. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also may consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. And then in verse 14 of Romans 6, it says, for sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. This is why this topic is important to me, because it speaks of what I was before and what I am now, and what the price that had to be paid for me and my sinfulness, my pridefulness, that Christ went to the extreme to pay a price for somebody who didn't deserve it. To deserve death. And that word forsaken, to think that God would turn his back on his own son. That was the crushing blow to me. Because the guilt that I had after reading that was I wept over the fact that God left him there to suffer alone, and it was because of me that he did it. But at the same time, I was extremely encouraged to know that my price was paid in full. Where there's other churches, other religions that believe that Jesus' blood wasn't sufficient enough. And now they have to go out and work to kind of equal or balance it out. Can't be done. It was done perfectly. And sufficiently. And therefore, I am thankful.